let it grow between us, and I cut my mind on second best. All the scars that come with the greenness, and I gave my eyes to the boredom. Still the seabed wouldn't let me in, and I tried my best to embrace the darkness in which I swim. Now walking back down this mountain, the strength of a turning tide, oh, the wind so soft at my skin. Yeah, the sun so hot upon my side. All looking out at this happiness, I search for between the sheets, or feeling blind to realize all I was searching for was me. Oh, oh, all I was searching for was me.
Welcome and good morning once more to Vox Church. So glad that you're here. Welcome, welcome. If I've never had the chance to meet you, my name is Mike Schnepp. I have the great honor of serving as our executive pastor here at Vox Church. I'm so glad to be with you. If you're new to Vox Church, Vox is one church in seven, soon to be eight, come on, New Britain, locations, which, man, we're just so excited about. And so right now we're streaming all the way down to Stamford, up to Springfield, and everywhere in between, Bridgeport, Hartford, Middletown, North Campus. Let us say hello. Come on. Good morning. Good morning. Really love you guys. Glad to be with you. If you're new here, I want to encourage you, before you go today, would you stop and say hello, connect with one of our leaders. We would love to meet you, love to answer any questions that you have, love to help you get connected here at Vox Church. So make sure you do that. We got a gift for you. Would love to get that in your hands before you go. All right. If you've been here over the last couple weeks, you know that we have been in a sermon series called Finding Colossus. And so we started 2 weeks ago as Justin, our lead pastor, began leading us down this journey of, boy, God has called us to a story bigger than ourselves. He's drawn us into his mythic epic story that God has written, and we have a part to play. Last week, we talked about the divide inside. Come on, the war raging inside. And we learned that, what did we learn, right? God's acceptance now releases the power to change. Anybody there for that? Come on, wasn't it good? If you missed any of those first 2 weeks, make sure you go back and get them, because we've got five more weeks in Finding Colossus, and they build one on top of another. And so you're going to want to make sure that you are a part of those, all right? Actually, Justin and Tim, our New Haven campus pastor, are actually down in Haiti right now doing some ministry. And so they'll be there until Thursday. And so if you want to be praying for them, you can do so. God's doing some really powerful things down there and using them in some great ways. So really excited about that. Hopefully get a chance to share some of that with you. But this morning, we are going to continue our journey of finding Colossus. This is week three, all right? If you've got your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. We're going to read the first five verses together, okay? Paul is writing. He says this. He says, "This is how one should regard us, as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found trustworthy. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. In fact, I don't even judge myself. For I am not aware of anything against myself, but I am not thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart." Let's bow our heads together and let's pray as we begin our time. So God in heaven, we thank you once more for who you are. We've worshiped you, we've sung about you, and now God, we just ask that you would change us. As we interact with your word, Holy Spirit, we thank you that you change us. And so we ask you that we would walk out as different people as a result of being here this morning. I thank you for your spirit among us, God. We cling to your grace. Right now, we just quiet our hearts before you, and we invite your spirit to speak to us. We ask these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. I want to bring you back with me to seventh grade geology class. It was an exceedingly awkward time for me. I don't know if it was same for you. It was full of pimples and voices that would squeak when I would speak up in class. I don't know how it was for you, but geology class. I remember in geology class learning about the earth. And our teacher, I think her name was Mrs. Rinkavage, was telling us all about how the earth is actually constructed of layers, you know? So as you look out at the earth, you know, what you see is not what goes all the way through, right? That's pretty common knowledge. And so as you look at the layers of the earth, come on, look with me. You've got the top, which is the crust, all right? The crust. And the crust is like 3 to 43 miles deep. It's the very thinnest portion of the layers of the earth. But right underneath that, you've got the mantle. The mantle is about 2,000 miles deep. It's huge. Right underneath that, then you've got the outer core. This place is hot. It's like 11,000 degrees. That's hot, right? And then right underneath that, right in the center of the earth, is the inner core, which holds everything together. And each layer has its own properties, has its own composition and characteristics that affects much of our earth. Now, I know you didn't come here for a geology class, but hang with me, right? Last week, we talked about the power to change, God's acceptance. We talked about the divide inside. And so we talked about, boy, what is true about me, right? I've got this war going on inside of me. How am I supposed to view myself? In light of Romans 8:1, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. That's on one side, right? And then on this side, I've got the war inside, the divide inside, the things that I don't want to do, I find myself doing. How do I reconcile those two things? Mike, how am I supposed to view myself in light of that reality? In light of the acceptance of God, but the war going on in my spirit, how am I supposed to reconcile those two things? Mike, how am I supposed to view myself? It's a critical question, is it not? It's a critical question. I don't know if you've ever had the opportunity to sit at the feet of somebody that you really, really respected. Last week, as Justin mentioned, he and I were down in Florida for a conference with our wives, and I had the opportunity to sit in front of John Maxwell. If you're not familiar with him, he's a guy who's been writing leadership books for like 50 years. He's written, I think, 82 books and been really, really impactful in my own development. He did a session, and I was like, just on the edge of my seat wanting to learn. Have you ever had the opportunity to learn from someone that you really respect? This morning, we actually get the opportunity to do that, to learn from one of the greats. Because Paul, more than I think anyone else other than Jesus in the New Testament, has figured out, who am I in Jesus? How am I supposed to view myself? And we get the opportunity to sort of lean in and hear straight from his mouth, how do you see yourself in light of the acceptance and the divide inside? And so he invites us, and he actually uses sort of this analogy that I'm going to present before us this morning of layers, that this identity of how we're supposed to see ourselves, who we are, it's not just one piece. There are layers to it, all right? And so we're going to begin to look at these layers together. And I would say this is incredibly important. It's an incredibly important week for us as we try and go after this idea of finding Colossus, of discovering who we are in Jesus so that we can live out the callings and destinies that he has put in front of us. Because many of us are suffering from broken mindsets, from misunderstandings about who we are, from labels that have been put on us by other people. And if we can't figure out who we are, we're never going to be able to walk free of those chains. And so a full understanding of who we are, I think Paul is going to help us with this morning. You know, there was a famous Jules Verne novel called Journey to the Center of the Earth. They made a couple different movies about it. They were not particularly successful if you saw them. But, you know, listen, this morning we're doing Journey to the Center of the Soul, right? You can elbow that person and say, that's kind of cheesy. Yeah, that's a little corny. Go ahead. You can tell them that, right? This morning, we're going to look at the four layers that comprise who you are. And I love that Paul just gets out in front of us and he says it. He's talking to the church at Corinth and he says, this is how you should regard us. This Paul is the same author who wrote last week about the divide inside. And so we know he understands the paradigm that we're looking at. And so he says, I want you to know, as he started a text, this is how you should regard us. This is how you should think about us, because this is how I view myself. You should then apply it to yourself, all right? And so he starts, and he says, hey, this is how you should regard us, as servants of Christ. And now it's an interesting word choice for Paul, isn't it? Notice that he doesn't say, I'm a student of Christ, or I'm even a follower of Christ. He uses this word, servant of Christ. And a servant back then, it's the same connotation for today. You know, you work for someone in authority. There is someone above you who has say over how you spend your time, and you're accountable to someone above you, right? It's the idea of a servant. This is not unfamiliar to us. I serve the purpose of my master above myself. And we talk often here at Vox about how Jesus is supposed to be our first priority. That there are a lot of different hats that we wear, dad and friend and a lot of different things, employee. But the thing that is supposed to be primary to us is Jesus. That he is supposed to be our first priority. And so he's just reminding us of things that, you know, most of us would say we agree with and that we know. And so then we've got to ask ourselves the question, what does it mean to be a servant of Jesus? How do I follow him, you know? Well, Jesus tells us in Matthew chapter 6, and he kind of breaks it down pretty simply for us because he says, teacher, and they're asking this to Jesus, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Read this. Maybe you've heard it before, but it says, and Jesus replied to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. That is, unselfishly seek the best or higher good for others. Jesus tells us, listen, I'm going to boil it all down. Two commandments of what it means to follow me, what it means to be a servant of Christ. You love me first, and then you love other people. Next question, you know? He keeps it pretty simple for us, right? And it's helpful because it gives us clarity to how we're to view our day. We're not going to spend a lot of time here because I think we're a pretty intelligent crowd, are we not? Right? We understand what it means to be a servant of Jesus and what it is to prioritize him. But it means that we launch into every single day seeking first to love God and then throughout our day to love others extremely well. And again, I don't want to linger here because we talk about this a lot, but I want you to understand that as Paul is unpacking for us this new identity, we're going to call the layer, the crust, if you will. The first one is this. The first layer of my new identity is servant. I am driven to love. How am I supposed to view myself? First, as a servant who is driven to love. Now listen, just because it's simple to understand doesn't mean it's easy to live out, right? I don't always like spending time with God, right? Sometimes I just want to get on with it. Frankly, I don't always like spending time with people. Can we be honest? People are kind of crazy. Some of you are legitimately a little bit crazy, right? Come on now. Let's be honest about that. You know what it's like. You don't always like being with people. It's not always easy to love God and love people. I don't always feel like it. You know, Mother Teresa said something similar. She said, thank God we don't serve God with our feelings. Otherwise, I don't know where I would be. And then she goes, pray for me. Like, that's the quote, you know? And I feel much better about myself knowing that Mother Teresa struggled with something similar, right? Can we be honest about that? I don't always feel like loving other people. Sometimes people drive me a little crazy. I legitimately sometimes hide from people. Can we be honest? Right? Any introverts in the room? Like, you know where you're going to hide, right? Sometimes you just gotta hide. I kid you not, vulnerable moment. When I graduated college, I used to be an engineer. I graduated and we worked in this open office environment, which is code word for like introvert hell, right? Open office space is like, you can't get away. You can't shut a door. There are no doors. It's like, this is awful. And I literally would get so fed up with it that I would go hide in the bathroom because nobody's bothering you in the bathroom, right? That's like the secret place. And so I'd go and they probably thought I had like bowel problems, but I was just like, I just need a minute, right? And I just need a minute. Come on, can we be honest, right? Sometimes all the extroverts are like, that's weird. All the introverts are like, that's brilliant. I'm gonna try that. I like that. I like that. All right, so where do we go then? We got to ask ourselves the question, where do I find the motivation to love? Where do I find the motivation to love? Because it's not always easy and it doesn't always come naturally. So where do I go? Well, we got to dig a little deeper. Let's look at the next layer. Got to keep digging. Paul goes on, he says, I am a steward of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found faithful. Now, steward is a bit of a strange word, right? It's not a word that we use. Last time I can think of us using it is like as airline stewards, and that's apparently not PC anymore. So we don't really talk about stewards, right? What exactly does a steward mean if that's what we're supposed to be? Well, let's let the Bible actually translate it for us. You know, you hear Jesus talk in several of his parables about stewards of a master's good. Peter talks in 1 Peter 4:10, and he says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. What is he saying? He's saying, listen, you got to be a steward of God's grace. What is he telling us? A steward is someone who invests something into someone else. It's almost like a stockbroker who invests somebody else's goods. You know, the stockbroker doesn't own it, but they are investing what is somebody else's, okay? So this is a steward. It's somebody who oversees and someone who invests. So I'm like, all right, I can get that. And then Paul says, you're to be a steward of, and I'm like, okay, great, the mysteries of God. I'm like, that's definitely clear. Thanks, Paul. You know? What on earth does he mean when he says, you are to be a steward of the mysteries of God? Well, thankfully, he uses the same phrase over in Colossians 1, and he helps us understand what he means by this. Check this out. He says, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery. The mystery, same exact word in the Greek. Okay. Riches of the glory of this mystery, which is, yes, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Okay, the mysteries of God are that Christ lives in me and the hope that lives inside me of glory. So you got to put these two things together, all right? To be a steward of the mysteries of God means that I am to invest the hope of Jesus into other people. You know what that means? You and I have been given a divine mission to spread the hope and the joy and the peace and the resurrection power of Jesus. We have been given a mission. That's what it means. It sounds pretty simple on the surface, but imagine if every day you woke up looking at it like this. And I'm so tired of people talking about, man, I'm just a stay-at-home mom. You know, I'm just an accountant. I'm just a student. I'm just a college student. You know, one day I'll be something. You're not just anything, okay? God has put you in a unique circumstance. He has called you to serve him, love other people by investing his hope directly into their hearts. Every single day you wake up with divine purpose and divine mission, right? This is who you're called to be. God has chosen you to be a conduit of his grace. You are a steward of the mysteries of God. You have been sent by him. And so when serving gets tiring, you remember that your life is bigger than your own. When it gets a little hard to keep loving those difficult people, you remember that you have something they need, the love of God, the hope of glory. The divine mission over your life is that you would take what God has given you, the hope of salvation, and you would inject it by investing it in as many hearts as you can find. It's no coincidence that God has built you into the family he's built you in. You're not in that job for no purpose. You are meant to be a light in that dark place. And imagine, that'll get you up in the morning, right? See, if we're gonna look for that reason to love, I'm gonna be a servant of Christ, I need to know how because it's hard. You know what it is? It's that hope in heaven is a real thing. That life is short and God has brought me into this situation to be an ambassador of hope. Every day you wake up with that mission. And I know when I wake up thinking about that, I can find what I need to love people. I can know what it looks like to go after God because I know that he has given me that hope. We're going to say it this way. That the second layer of this identity, right, is I steward, I invest my hope. Now, if we're honest, this is something that we really like talking about. But we've got to ask ourselves what is a really honest and probably for some of us, challenging question. Yeah, okay, I can do that. I'll invest hope into other people's hearts. I'll steward the mysteries of God. When was the last time we actually did that? And I'm not trying to be judgmental. I'm just asking you to take a little bit of inventory. When was the last time you spoke encouragement into the heart of another believer? That you passed on the joy and the hope and the peace that God has given you into a moment when they needed it most? When was the last time you looked at a coworker and you invited them to church? When was the last time you had a friend and you told them about Jesus? It's easy for us to talk about, but man, it is sometimes hard for us to live out, okay? I just ask you to just kind of take that and just wrestle with it, all right? But we got to go deeper. That's only the second layer, all right? Doing okay? Doing all right? Come on, let's keep going. Let's keep digging a little bit. All right, here it goes. He continues on. He says this. We're two layers down. He says, but with me is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. In fact, I do not even judge myself, for I am not aware of anything against myself, but I am not thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me. It is the Lord who judges me. I love hearing about old part-time jobs, right? don't know if you've got some crazy old part-time jobs. I used to work at Chili's for a while. Worked at a furniture store, but my job I had the longest in high school was I worked at American Eagle. Come on, you didn't know how cool I was, did you? Right? And I was actually a model. No, I definitely wasn't, right? Not at all. I was like, hey, you want to take a picture of me in these clothes? They're like, no, just sell them and give credit cards away that people don't need. It's like, okay, great, I'll fold the clothes, you know? And I remember there was a year when we lost, over the course of 6 months, $22,000 worth of merchandise. It went missing, okay? We did inventory. That's a lot of $9 t-shirts, okay? Somebody had been going home with plaid shirts and jeans over and over. And so the organization, American Eagle, actually sent up internal affairs to our store. Not even kidding, right? It is, you have to be a criminal mastermind to take $20,000 of clothing. That is not easy. So they're like, we gotta figure out who this person is. And so they come up and they actually interview every single one of the employees. They send up this tall, intimidating guy from North Carolina, I remember so clearly, and they start interviewing every employee. And I had the unfortunate circumstances of being the very first person that they interviewed. So I didn't know what to expect, right? I didn't know what was coming, but this guy literally, he takes me for a walk and he's like, pleasantries. Hey man, how long you been here? How long you been there? And then it turns and he goes, what if I told you I know you stole all $20,000? I was like, what? And I'm like, and he's like, I'm not kidding. And I was like, I didn't steal it. He's like, I have it on good record, on cameras, that you are the thief of these $20,000. And I'm like, I'm not. And like, let me just answer, I wasn't. You know, some of you are like, did you? Like, no, I didn't, right? I actually didn't steal the money, but I didn't steal the clothes. But he literally was using, you know, intimidation tactics to get you to fold. And I was like, I didn't, I promise you I didn't. He's like, I know you did it, sign right here. And I was like, I don't think I wanna do that, right? And so, but I remember the helpless feeling of feeling like, man, I'm being accused of something that I didn't do, but I have no real way of making a defense. The very same way you are sitting underneath the accusations of a supernatural being who hates you and wants to ruin your life. Can we have a sober, honest conversation about that? Did you know that the name Satan actually means accuser? Right now, some of us know what it's like to have the accusations of the devil just begin to pile up over us. God could never love you. If he knew what you had done, if anyone else knew, you would understand why you're not worthy of love. You don't matter to anyone. No one could ever love you. You're not important. You don't matter. Every single day, the accuser is launching lies at us. And it's sad because many of us have begun to accept those things as realities. We don't understand that they're a scheme of the devil who is just literally trying to ruin our lives. And so we've begun basically saying, yeah, maybe I am. Maybe I am worthless. Maybe I am unlovable. But the truth is our souls cannot stand up under the crush. That's why they put the backup right there. That's good. I like that. Production for the win. Well done. Thank you, production. Always prepared. Kind of an inopportune moment, microphone. Thank you very much. All day long, you're being just thrown at with these lies. And the question that we've got to wrestle with, the soul can't stand up underneath the onslaught of these things, so we start looking for a defense. The prosecution, Satan, is pointing his finger in our face saying, God could never love you. You don't matter. But we've got to find an answer to this question. And so we oftentimes just begin to look to other things around us to answer it. How do I know that I should have any self-worth, self-regard? Where do I find it? And so we begin to define ourselves by our jobs. We look for value in relationships. We look for anything that we can be good at to say, see, I do matter. But Paul says, and he uses this courtroom analogy, which is so helpful because sometimes that's just what it feels like. And he says, listen, you remember what he said? He says, here's the deal. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or any human court. And he's just like super blunt. He basically is saying, listen, it doesn't really matter to me what you think about me. It just doesn't really matter. you know, which is such a foreign concept for many of us, because if we're honest, for many of us, it matters a lot what the people in our lives think about us. Oftentimes, a little too much. But we get to a place where we hear Paul say that and we go, good for you, Paul. Because our answer in society is, listen, as long as you feel good about who you are, who cares what everyone thinks? You do you. That's our answer. But did you notice? That's not where Paul goes. That's not his answer. He says this instead. He says, in fact, I don't even judge myself. But his answer is this. It is the Lord who judges me. See, for Paul, he has finally found the secret. He's finally gotten the ultimate verdict that each of us so desperately look for. And for him, in this courtroom analogy, his trial is over. It doesn't matter that there's a prosecution lying to him. He says, listen, I'm not on trial anymore. Satan is sitting there going, listen, did you know Paul used to murder Christians? He actually gave himself to seeing your love eradicated from this earth. And God says, I know. Jesus stands in and says, listen, this trial is over. I have stood in for him. Yes, he did those things. But because of what I've done, God doesn't hold them against him anymore. You ever seen that? Come on, that's the beauty. Colossians 2. You got to see this. He stands up in front of Paul and he says, Paul has no value and no worth. He's got so much crap behind him. Can we say that in church? I don't know, but we did. Okay, listen. Colossians 2, if you don't have this one memorized, get it. It says this, and you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses. How did he do that? Come on. By canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. And he disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to open shame by triumphing over them in him. Jesus storms into the courtroom, right? He storms into the courtroom and he says, all those things you're accusing him of, I already paid for them on the cross. So sit down, Satan, you have no case. It's all done, right? It's done. It's done. He's done it for Paul and he's done it for you. And I pray that you grab a hold of this. You don't need to sit under condemnation anymore. Romans 8:1, we studied it last week. In Christ, there is no condemnation. Listen, Satan's going to keep lying to you, but you just fight that with truth, right? We learn to bring the truth of God against it. He walks in and he says, listen, I took the blame so that you wouldn't have to. I took the shame so that you could be honored. I was guilty so that you could be accepted. And that's the beauty of the transfer that happens at the cross. So you see, justification is more than just being not guilty. It's actually a bestowal of status. See, it's one thing to go, boy, I know God doesn't hold my sin against me anymore. It's another thing altogether to know that God is looking at you and saying, you are my beloved son and beloved daughter. I have an inheritance waiting for you in heaven, and I can't wait for you to get here because I love you, right? That's the beauty of the transfer of status. That's who we are in Jesus. And we got to grab a hold of that. We have perfection and sonship all poured into our account based on what Jesus has done. And so now we take those big questions. Now we take these questions of worth and of value. And we say, man, do I even matter? And God immediately answers, do you matter? Did you see what Christ went through on the cross? That's how you know you matter. Am I held guilty? He says, no, no, no. I've nailed those things to the cross. God, how do you feel about me? I love you like a son. You're a part of my family. Your questions finally find the answers that they so desperately need to find. And they find them here. The judge has declared you once and for all loved, worthy, accepted, righteous, adopted. And this is the third layer. Don't miss this. So important. We'll call it this. They call it the outer core, the third layer. We're going to call it just simply saved. The verdict is in. Your soul has finally found the verdict it needed in Jesus. Finally. You know, I remember early on when I was dating my wife, we were teenagers when we started, and I remember being on the phone in the dorm I was in. I didn't have a cell phone. I was on a plastic dorm phone. Like, that's how old this was, right? Long time. I didn't have a cell phone. Like, that's unfathomable now, right? I didn't have a cell phone. And I remember we were on the phone, and we had been dating like 2 months. not very long, and we weren't following Jesus at the time. And I remember I asked this like dumb leading question that like was just looking for some affirmation. And instead of answering, she goes, and again, I barely even knew this girl. She was like, "You're fishing." And I was like, "What does that mean?" She goes, "You're fishing for a compliment. Don't do that." And I was like, "That's cold, but that's true." Like, I was just deeply insecure, and I was just looking to her for validation, you know? And like, we do this in relationships. See, I didn't have a relationship with God. I wasn't receiving the validation from Him that I needed, and so I was just looking for it in other places. And you know, as we've grown, as we've fallen more in love with one another, but more importantly, fallen in love with God, I've learned that our relationship works best when we are each receiving from God what He is meant to give us and not looking to one another to give what only God is meant to give, right? That's the essence of human relationships that work. And so that's why this third layer is so important. See, the first two layers sit on our ability to love other people well. It's very, very hard to love them if you're constantly looking for something from them. Ever notice that sometimes relationships fall apart when you squeeze them just a little bit too tight? See, sometimes we replace the gift and we look at it and we go, "Man, this is supposed to be the giver." And God goes, No. You receive your validation and your value from me, and then you can give it to other people, you know? It's like we have this cup. The best way to love people is when our cup is overflowing with God's grace and we can just give it out to other people. I'm not going to my wife or my friend or my brother with an empty cup saying, "Hey, please fill me." They're going, no, I can't do that. That's what God is supposed to do. But once my cup is full and I begin pouring it out, listen, God is going to surround you with people who need to be filled. And so if we're going to stand on this, if we're going to do these first two things well, if I'm going to love God and then love people, and then I'm going to spend my life injecting the hope of God into other people's hearts, I need to love them from a position of acceptance, not need, or I'm not going to have that many people to love. Amen? Amen. All right, come on, let's keep digging together. We got one more thing I want to look at, okay? All right, here we go. Paul continues and he says, "Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the," what? "The heart." The heart. At the end of it all, it all boils down to one thing. As Paul is leading us and driving us deeper into this identity in Christ, the inner core, the thing that makes us who we are, is the heart. The heart comprises who we are. I mean, one author describes it this way. It's helpful. He says, "Heart in Scripture is considered the very center and core of life." And that's right. He says, the heart is the deep center of our life, the innermost part of the human personality, the center of those qualities that make us human. The heart is who we are, the real self. And you say, "Man, if that's true, did you miss last week? Like, my heart seems like it's a mess. It feels like I have a divided heart. It feels like, man, I'm not living in a pure way," but you got to check this out. Hebrews 10:14. Listen to this. "For by that one offering," talking about Jesus and the cross, "he forever made perfect those who are being made holy." Okay? He made perfect. He has given you the new heart who are being made holy. That means even as your outer layers are still being worked on, God has given you a new heart and decreed you holy, blameless. See, many of us think, "Man, at the core of me, I'm not good. I have these tendencies. I have these things." And it's holding you back because God wants you to know, "Listen, I have put my spirit in you. There's a new identity available to you. Stop wearing the old mindsets. You have a new heart." Maybe you've heard Ezekiel 36 where it says this, "And I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you. I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey your rules." You have this morning through faith in Jesus a new heart. And you need to understand this because it's a dramatically different framework to how we see the world. See, at the cross, God gives us the verdict that we needed. And with an empty tomb, resurrection life, he gives us the heart that we need. And out of that heart, we begin understanding who we are. For the very first time, we can finally understand who we are. Jesus promises us when he says, I have come in John chapter 10:10, that you may have life to the full. Some translations say abundant life, overflowing from a new heart. And it might sound simple. It might sound like, man, you know, what's the big deal? Like, you know, it matters because at the heart is where you find the definition of yourself. You understand that? See, some of us, when we think about ourselves, we say, man, I'm a loser. I'm a failure. I'm broken. My past has disqualified me. Or maybe people have spoken it over you, right? Your teacher that said you were never gonna amount to anything. And you just think, man, at the core of who I am not good. God says, listen, enough with those old mindsets. It's time for them to be broken off. At the core of who you are is my spirit living within you. You are a child of God. You are a son or a daughter. I love you. I have purpose for you. I have a calling on your life. But as long as you keep living in those old mindsets, living in those old identities, as long as you keep thinking at the center of who you are is that old person, you will never break forth into who you are and who I've called you to be. And so it's so important that when we think about who we are, this idea of mindset, in light of the great war, the war inside, who am I? I am first and foremost a child of God who is growing in the likeness of Jesus. And I don't look like him yet, but day by day I'm looking more like him because I have a new heart and it is good. And it is good. And you've got to see, listen, if you grab a hold of this, the possibilities are endless. The possibilities are endless. Imagine you took a fresh look at that addiction. Today you walked in and you said, man, I think that thing's just always gonna be with me. Imagine if you began to look at that thing and you said, hey, here's the deal. I'm gonna just choose to believe that at the core of who I am is a good heart in which the Holy Spirit resides. There's promise that where the Spirit of the Lord is there is freedom. You can't break that addiction on your own, but with the Holy Spirit living inside of you, you can break it, right? You know, you've got that thing that you're waiting for. All these various things that you're believing God for, and you say, man, I'm just not good enough. Nonsense. God has given you everything you need to walk out the purpose and calling of which he's called you to. God did not knit you together in your mother's womb in Psalm 139, like he tells us, just to give you an ordinary life. He has called you to more than that. And so often, I think we're holding ourselves back because we're afraid to believe that it might actually be true. That it might actually be true, that God has taken up residence in our hearts. You know, in Scripture, Jesus is called the seed. And in many ways, this seed has been planted in our hearts. The Holy Spirit takes up residence. And this is the core of who you are. It's the core of your innermost being, the inner core that holds everything together, that everything else is built on. You need to understand you are made new. You are a new creation. It's not just catchy lingo. It is the core of your new identity. Grab hold. Grab hold. And change the way you think. We're going to say it this. Seed, which is Christ in me. I have a new heart. I have a new heart. And so what do? Where do we go from here? I want to tell you, I'm actually really excited. Justin next week is sharing on, in light of this new heart, how do I live? How do I live out this new heart? But today your one and only job is to receive. To receive this new identity. To receive the identity that says, boy, first I'm a servant that views the world through the lens of a servant. That says, I'm gonna love God passionately and pursue him. And then I'm gonna love others well. And then I've got the stewardship mentality that sets me on mission, that says I have the greatest gift on earth. The truth that God has a plan for my sister's life, that God has a plan for my coworker's life, that God has put me and made me interact with them so that I can share that. And I can love them well. I can love them without pretense and without expectation because I've received love from God first. And I've received the love from God because he's given me a new heart. And this is the framework for our new identity. Come on, let's stand together. This morning, we receive. We receive. Next week, we tackle the question, but today, we just receive. There are many of us who are just struggling right now to receive. I want to pray. God, we just say right now, this is not simple for us. God, you call us just to receive this new identity, but it's hard when we've walked in so many different identities for so long. And so we just say, would you help us? God, like that father in Mark 9 where he says, I believe, but help my unbelief. We come to you just saying, God, this is hard for us to believe sometimes. And we just confess that. Would you help us? God, even right now, as we confess who we are in you, I pray that you would fill us with fresh faith that it's true. That God, you would open up our hearts so that we can receive this truth. We are not what has been spoken of us. We are who you say we are. And we sing that truth over our minds. We sing it over our hearts. And we receive it in faith. In the name of Jesus, we pray.